Greetings, geeks, and welcome to a special installment of Wizards, the podcast guide to comics. Today we have a very, very interesting thing to talk about. We're here to talk about one of the most legendary movies in the Marvel Universe canon. Why is it so legendary? Well, it's based on the first ever Marvel comic. It was one of the early Marvel movies, and as of today, it has never seen an official release. We're speaking, of course, about the 1994 Fantastic Four movie directed by Ole, is it Sassoon or Sassoon?
Sassoon, yes.
And produced by Roger Corman. Infamous friend of the show, pal of mine, Steven Tsapelas, who brought this film to me. Steven, how are you tonight?
I am, in a word, fantastic. I'm so excited to be talking about this movie. I don't want to bury the lead here, but I'm going to start with the lead. This is my favorite Marvel movie. This might be my favorite Marvel thing ever. In the entire canon of Marvel, nothing has topped my love for Corman's Fantastic Four.
Really?
I am just so thrilled to be here.
Let's see. All right.
You better love this movie.
I have lots of thoughts and feelings, and we'll go in. We'll dive deep into it.
Okay, good. I was built for this. I have so many props too.
Do you really?
Got this.
There's a Blu-ray. Don't show me anymore. I want to be surprised.
All right.
This is fascinating. So I have a lot to say about this movie, but I'm going to save it for once we get into the actual part of the movie. So we'll dive into it because I have a lot to say, and I'm sure you have a lot to say as well. And I fully expect us to go potentially, I'm predicting, 4 hours in this podcast. So we might break this into like a Snyder cut version of the show where we drop an hour a week for a couple of weeks. And yeah, there's also a documentary about this movie, which we're going to discuss as well.
Yes, there is. And it's great. Oh, sorry. I'm just saying everything. I just love it, so I have no negative thing to say.
He's not biased at all for this film. With me this evening is, fittingly, the two guys from Long Island. Our story starts on Long Island, specifically, on the Woodmere golf course, where DC Comics publisher Martin Leibovitz was playing a couple of rounds with Marvel publisher Martin Goodman. Leibovitz was bragging to Goodman about the sales of his new book, The Justice League. So Goodman went to Marvel editor Stan Lee and introduced him to create a knockoff version. As legend would have it, at this point, Stan was ready to quit the comic industry altogether, so his wife suggested he go for broke and tell the story he wanted to tell.
So I really wanted to quit and try something else. And I remember Joan said to me, "You know, Stan, if you want to quit, before you do, why don't you do one book the way you would like to do it? The worst that happens is Martin will fire you, and so what? You want to quit anyway." So coincidentally, at that time, he had found out that our competitor, DC Comics, which called itself National Comics in those days, they had done a book called The Justice League of America, a group of superheroes, and it was selling very well. And he said to me, "Stan, why don't you do a book about a group of superheroes?" So I figured this is my chance to do it my way. So I came up with something I called the Fantastic Four, about four superheroes. But instead of making them heroes who wore costumes, I figured I'm not going to give them costumes. Because I always felt if I had a superpower, why would I want to put on a costume? First of all, I'm too much of a show-off. I'd want everybody to know it's me. I would never wear a mask. And why would I need a costume? If I could jump over a building, I don't have to wear a colorful costume. I'll just jump over the building. At any rate, I didn't give them costumes. And I tried to make them real characters living in the real world.
To quote Stan Lee, "For just once, I would do the type of story I myself would enjoy reading, and the characters would be the kind of characters I could personally relate to. They'd be fresh and bold."
You wrote flesh, fresh and blood.
Oh, flesh and blood. I'm sorry.
It's okay.
I can't read, folks. So they'd be flesh and blood. They'd have their faults and, what does it say?
Foibles?
Foibles?
Yeah.
Okay, Stanley. All right. They'd be fallible and feisty. And most important of all, inside their colorful costumes, inside their colorful costumed booties, they'd still have feet of clay.
He was someone who liked the English language quite a bit.
Yeah, I think he also liked the LSD as well.
Well, if you read any of, like, you know, the original issues of the Marvel comics, mm-hmm. and you read, you know, Stan's soapbox or any of his bullpen stuff, it's all this kind of flowery language.
Wow, interesting.
It's a lot of fun.
I haven't read a lot of early Marvel stuff, just because it's like, it's so hard to go back and, like, I don't want to go down that rabbit hole, but whatever. They are very much based on Stan's personal life. Invisible Woman was modeled after his wife, Joan. Jack Kirby is Ben Grimm, obviously.
Yeah. And Stan thought of himself as Mr. Fantastic.
Of course he did.
It was kind of based on him. The smartest person in the universe.
In the room. Obviously. Yeah, obviously. Of course. Do you want to talk about some of the background of the Fantastic Four?
Sure. So it debuted in November of 1961. And the first 100 issues are kind of considered the premier Stan Lee, Jack Kirby collaboration. This is what kicked off the Marvel Age of Comics. There'd be no Iron Man, Thor, X-Men, or Spider-Man without the Fantastic Four.
I believe that.
And so now let me ask you a question there, Michael. Were you a fan of the Fantastic Four growing up?
You know what? I remember the cartoon. There was a short-lived cartoon show, mm-hmm. and I really did enjoy that. I've always had mixed feelings about Reed Richards. When I was younger, I didn't really understand the Thing all that much. I always kind of thought he was more or less a knockoff Hulk, as opposed to the other way around. I've always been a fan of the Invisible Woman, because who doesn't love the idea of being able to go invisible and, like, go through walls and all that kind of stuff? I thought that was just, you know, one of my favorite things. Like, as a kid, you're like, oh man, I just wish I could be invisible and I could, you know, be a fly on the wall, so to speak. And in an R-rated movie, I want to be Invisible Woman and go into the room and see the movie, kind of thing.
Like Scott Baio.
Yeah.
In Zapped.
Yeah.
Yeah. This was my favorite comic book growing up. My favorite Marvel comic book was Fantastic Four. It was the first comic book I ever had a subscription to.
Really?
And, yeah. And from like 92 to 95, I was like picking up every issue. So when this movie, the word of this movie dropped, I was so primed for this. And around this time, they were doing the Death of Reed Richards storyline. I don't know if you remember that one.
I don't. I didn't know that he had, you know, died at one point. I mean, I know he has died a few times, but I didn't know there was one that early.
Yeah, it was kind of the Ralph Macchio run, and they killed off Reed Richards and Dr. Doom.
Wait, and Ralph Macchio, Karate Kid, or
no, the writer. Right. It's Ralph Macchio. It's spelled the same. But he pronounces it differently.
Gotcha. You know, Ralph Macchio is from Long Island, too. That's why I was kind of like, hmm.
Well, he's the king of Long Island. And if you go to any pizzeria, there's an autographed photo of Ralph Macchio or Steve Guttenberg or Jerry Seinfeld. Oh, yes.
That is true. That is true.
Ralph Macchio, the king of Long Island. Or Ralph Macchio, the king of Long Island. Ralph Macchio, the Fantastic Four writer. Yeah, but like I was so into it at this point. And Mr. Fantastic is my favorite Marvel character.
Really?
Just love him. I just love him. I love any character that's
super pompous,
intelligent, pompous. I love pompous. And yeah, like there's just something about Mr. Fantastic where as a kid, I just thought he was the coolest human being, you know?
Interesting.
Got a beautiful wife. He turned his best friend into a rock man. The world looks up to him as like, you know, the smartest guy who can do anything. And he can stretch. He can stretch any part of his body.
Yeah, oh, fair enough. Touche. So let's, you know, theatrically, there was only really one Marvel movie, which was Howard the Duck. There had been a couple of other things like The Incredible Hulk, the Doctor Strange TV show, TV movies, you know, Captain America was released theatrically internationally, as was The Punisher, but were direct to video in America. None of them really had that great of a reputation, though, you know, I do like the, you know, direct to TV, like, Spider-Man movies, like the, you know, the Chinese Web and the, whatever the first one was called. Was it just called Amazing Spider-Man? I forget what it was called.
Yeah, the pilot, I believe that's what it was called.
Yeah.
Something similar.
Yeah. But, you know, the movies oftentimes were kind of dark, you know, other than the Spider-Man films, and they were not kid-friendly. Can you tell us, like, the origin of this Fantastic Four movie that we're going to dive into?
Yes. So, you know, throughout the 70s and 80s, Marvel was just kind of selling off their properties piecemeal for, you know, bargain basement prices.
Right.
And a German producer named Bernd Eichinger purchased the rights to Fantastic Four in the 1980s for $250,000.
Wow.
So that low, that's how little they were valuing it for. And so, you know, basically this movie went into production because his rights were going to expire in 1 year. And he needed to make the movie in order to retain the rights.
Hmm.
So he started shopping it around, and he started shopping it around to really low budget producers, including Lloyd Kaufman, who famously runs Troma Films. And at the time, their big thing was Toxic Avenger. So they were
right.
Kind of in the superhero realm. If you like Troma, I think it's disgusting.
Yeah.
And he ended up getting in touch with his friend, Roger Corman. So I'm sure you know who Roger Corman is, Michael, as a film person.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, I wasn't a big fan of any Roger Corman films per se, but you know, he's a name that you always hear in film school, and you know, he was synonymous of, you know, low budget films basically.
For those, yeah, he was kind of the king of the drive-ins.
Yeah.
You know, like he made biker flicks and women in prison movies, naughty nurse movies, the Edgar Allan Poe movies. But at this point in his career, he was more or less only doing direct-to-video. He had just directed his first movie, I think, in something like 20 years called Frankenstein Unbound.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
But his main production company was doing direct-to-video movies.
Okay. I forgot all about that. See, this is what happens. You know, like, man, you know, once you get older, your brain kind of, like, things just fall apart. But, you know, the production on this film is like legendary in its kind of its drama behind it, right? Like, so they
yes.
started, yeah. So they started shooting it on December 28th of 92, kind of like in a rush. Like people were like really, really weirded out by like why it was like such a hurry to get this film shot. And it continued into January of 93, shot at the last possible second in order to retain the rights. Scripted by Craig J. Nevius?
Nevius, yeah.
Yeah. And Kevin Rock. What a cool name is Kevin Rock. Yeah. So Nevius got the job because he wrote a Corman movie called Step Monster, which had a ton of comic book references, and went on to write the Black Scorpion TV series. I had never heard of the Black Scorpion TV
series. Oh, man. It was very much kind of ripping off the Adam West Batman, but in like a seedy silk stockings 90s kind of way.
Really?
There's an episode where Adam West plays the villain.
No kidding.
I believe it's on Amazon Prime. You can check it out, but it's Joan Severin's playing kind of a scantily clad superhero.
That's pretty interesting.
It's worth checking out, sort of.
Yeah. I don't know. Sometimes some of the recommendations you gave me, I wonder. The budget of the film was somewhere between $1 and $2 million, which was actually a fairly large budget for a Roger Corman production, but not so much for a major superhero movie.
Yeah, and kind of the reason the budget discrepancy is so large is because Roger Corman was loaning out, you know, his studio space, his editors who were on staff, you know, stock footage that he had, props that he had. So it's kind of somewhere in that realm of $1 and $2 million, based on everything you read.
Speaking of that, you know, I don't want to jump too far ahead, but I learned in the documentary that a lot of the sets were the exact same sets as Carnosaur, just kind of like repainted.
Yep. Yeah.
That's pretty interesting.
Not only that, but there's a Roger Corman movie called The Trip from the 1960s, you know, with all those guys, Peter Fonda.
Mm-hmm.
And they use stock footage from The Trip in the outer space sequence when they get blasted by the cosmic rays. That's like 25-year-old footage.
Really?
Of people tripping out and seeing things from that movie, The Trip.
Wow. The whole film was shot in 18 days, which is, if you know anything about film, normally a film is shot a page a day if you're doing a feature-length film. So if it's 90 pages, 90 days, you know, something like that. Some more like independent films, they might shoot it in like 30 days or, you know, or 60 days. But for a major motion picture, generally speaking, it's like they shoot one page per day in a production. So to shoot the whole movie in 18 days is Herculean, to say the least. According to Sassoon, it was shot mostly on short end film stock. Do you want to explain what short end film stock is?
Yeah, so basically, you know, when you used to shoot on film, a reel was about 10 minutes long.
Right.
And at a certain point, you know, you're getting towards the end of the reel and you're thinking, oh gosh, I'm not going to be able to film what I need to film in like a minute or 30 seconds or whatever's left. So you would not use that part, you would not expose it, and you would save it for later. And so this was all the leftovers that they were shooting it on.
And
they weren't even using full film reels. They were using leftovers.
It's funny because if you've ever seen Fight Club, there's a scene in Fight Club where Tyler Durden is like in a movie projector room,
mm-hmm.
and he's inserting, you know, pornographic clips into film, and he points out the cigarette burn that pops up in the corner. And I saw several times in this movie, you could literally see the cigarette burn pop up, which is when... What that means is they're basically taping the film together, and there's a little boop. That's what happens from like a piece of tape in the corner before it was edited digitally.
Yep. Yeah. On all these bootlegs, you can see that
really
little cigarette burn. And sometimes when you watch, you know, older movies, if it's a bad print, you can still see the cigarette burn in it.
Yeah. It was filmed in Roger Corman's crappy studio in Venice, which I find very interesting. That's pretty cool, but it's not Venice, Italy. It's Venice, California. And so from what I heard was this studio was rough. They were dealing with rats all the time and all kinds of other, you know, weird issues where the actors, when they pulled up to the studio, were like, this is it? Like, this is where we're filming this thing?
Yikes. So just an aside here, you lived in Los Angeles. Did you ever encounter anything like this, this kind of low rent studio?
I mean, there's a lot of weird things like on the Sunset or just like off the Sunset Strip that you'll find some weird little, oh, this is where we're having our production of our commercial today or this. And you're just like, am I going to make it out of here? Am I going home tonight? something out of Saw you'll see sometimes.
Yes. I worked in a show called The Deadliest Warrior. I can reveal the story now.
Sure.
And it was shot at a terrible, terrible studio, I think in like downtown Los Angeles. And there was one day where they had me fill up the trunk of my car with ancient weapons like axes and swords. And they weren't protected at all. They were just like dumped in the trunk of my car.
Oh, good.
And on the drive, I'm thinking, if I get into a car accident and I just, and they find me and I'm just, there's swords and axes and maces through me. What are they going to think happened here?
Yikes.
Like, what a mystery for the officer on the scene of the crime who's just like, what the hell happened to this poor guy?
Call the coroner. We got a weird one here.
We got a human shish kebab. That's on the freeway.
Oh boy. Oh, LA. Oh, what a weird place.
It's a weird place. And when you hear like the stories in that documentary and you've lived in Los Angeles, it's such a connection.
Yeah.
Like, okay.
So notoriously, Stan Lee himself disowned the film, even though apparently he made several trips to the filming of the movie and seemed very positive about it during the production, but publicly he shunned the movie and said it doesn't exist, it'll never see the light of day, yada yada yada.
That's true, yeah. And we'll get to it, but later on he even said that it was never meant for release, which I think was something that I don't know how true that is, but we'll get to that.
Yeah, it's interesting to say the least. I have a question for you, and yes. I'll share my feedback. Is what did you think of the directing of the movie?
I think that given what Ole Sassoon had to work with, which we just described, 18 days, short end film stocks, repainted sets, that it's really good.
I'll be honest with you. So knowing the budget being what it was, it looks like it was shot to be a made-for-TV movie.
Mm-hmm.
And not to say that's bad, because like it's shot, obviously I saw it, if you guys want to find it, it's on a website called Daily Motion. And we'll post that on the Wizard social and so on and so forth, so you can find it. And it's shot like what you would see the Captain America movie look like, or the Spider-Man movies, or even the Incredible Hulk. Yes, it's a very dirty, low-grade version, because what you see online was dubbed from a VHS over VHS over whatever. You know, it's not a crisp, clean copy. But that being said, it doesn't look terrible. I mean, like, if you had to equate it to anything, a student film, maybe a little bit a step above a student film, by the look of the sets and everything. Like, if you had a NYU student with a significant budget, you could put something similar to this out overall.
Well, you know, to his credit, I think, you know, he moves the camera a lot. This is not a still movie.
Yeah, there's a lot of moving camera.
Yeah, and he gets really good performances out of everyone, in my opinion. We'll get to that.
I mean, every single character owns it. Like, mm-hmm. They really, really own the roles. Other than, I kind of feel like the only complaint that I had was, I don't want to go too deep into it yet because we have a lot of time to cover. The girl who plays Sue Storm, the woman who plays Sue Storm, she comes off as too doting. Like, she's just mm-hmm. like, she comes off very, very needy at times almost. And that's not the Sue Storm that I envisioned, mm-hmm. but it could be the way that Stan Lee wrote her originally early on. And this movie feels the most comic book movie I've ever seen.
Yes, I'd agree with that.
100%.
A couple points there. There's so much to dissect with this movie. If you compare this to the other Corman movies that were coming out at this point, if you look at anything from this library, the New Horizons library, this is far and away better than any other movie Roger Corman was making at this point.
Oh, yeah.
And it shows, because I think, and you know, if you watch the documentary, if you read any interview with him, he really cared about the source material. And to your point about Sue Storm, he was basing it on those early Lee and Kirby issues, where she was basically that character.
Right.
That was their model for her.
That's kind of, I mean, it. Every character feels very archetype, original, true to the 60s. Style of writing and comic books and that kind of stuff. It's not what you would think. Like, if you're going looking in it with 2020 eyes, it's not that. It's written like it's early 60s style storytelling of comic books.
Definitely. And it looks like if this had come out in 1967, if I told you that, you would have 100% believed me when I showed it to you. It's got that vibe to it.
Yeah. So Ole was a comic book fan, and he talks about it in the documentary, which you can find on Amazon Prime also. It's called Doomed. It's very, very interesting that we'll be talking about it. He was also a Corman guy, which, what does that mean exactly?
He was part of the stable of direct-to-video Corman directors, which is how he got this. It was just, you know, they had their staff of guys, and him being a comic book fan, he, I guess, was first on the list. He had directed, if you want me to skip ahead here.
Yeah, sure.
He had directed a Corman movie called Blood Fist 3, Forced okay. to Fight, and Final Embrace. Blood Fist 3, obviously, classic prison break movie. So he was kind of in that world. He directed a lot of direct-to-video 90s movies.
Interesting. So he has a quote here where it says, "We tried to do everything from like nothing existed after the first, like as far as we knew, and what we based this on, there was no other comic except number one," which makes a lot of sense in the idea that these characters are written as if they are right out of the pages of the first issue of the Fantastic Four.
Mm-hmm.
Makes a ton of sense. He also goes on to say, "We have to make this feel like it's more 60s than not." Again, you can totally see that in every aspect. Even the costumes, the whole thing feels like it's right out of the 60s.
Yeah, and even on the audio commentary track, they say they tried to source furniture that looked like it was from the 1960s.
There's an audio commentary of this?
Michael, you're going to go deep into the world of the
Corman Fantastic Four. I'm going to have to rewatch this just to watch the director's commentary. Oh, boy, wow. This is going to take 6 years away from my life.
It's a very good commentary track. I'll say that for it.
I'm sure it is. So let's dive into the cast here, because I have a lot of thoughts about the cast. Right?
Okay, good.
Okay. So Alex Hyde White is Mr. Fantastic. He's been in a ton of film and TV. Probably his best known performance is in The Last Crusade. When you just see his arm, notably, he has a role in Pretty Woman. He also... Go ahead.
Do you remember him in Last Crusade? He plays the young Sean Connery at the beginning.
Is that really him?
That's really him. That opening sequence when River Phoenix runs in and he's like, count to dead in Greek. That's Alex Hyde White's arm.
No way.
So yeah.
But he's like his back to him and everything. Like,
yep. Yeah, that's probably his biggest role up to this point. But Spielberg did work with him again later on in Catch Me If You Can.
Okay.
He has a role, I think, as an FBI agent in that movie. And I remember I was in theaters, packed house, and he shows up and I'm like, oh my God, it's Mr. Fantastic. No one knew what I was talking about. But I freaked out.
So I wanted to just give you a heads up. In order to do this podcast, I had to pour myself a glass of wine, so I'll be occasionally drinking wine while we're discussing this movie because I feel like I needed to have something because I was like, oh, I want to just dive into this. And I wish I also had like a leather couch that I could sprawl out as we talk about this thing.
A little pipe that you can smoke and the bourbon glass.
Jolly good. He also appeared in the TV movie Captain America 2, Death Too Soon. And an episode of Mantis. Interesting. Listen, he looks like Reed Richards in this movie. Like, he looks a lot like him. I really did not care for the way they did the white sideburns that well. Like, they look like they're, you know, either clip-ons or something. But overall, like, he does kind of exude Reed Richards in this role, and he talks like how I would think Reed Richards would talk.
I agree with you, and when you watch the later Fantastic Four movies, they came they always portray Reed as this total nerd, and everyone's always like, oh, geez, Reed, you're going on and on about stuff no one cares about. And in this movie, they treat him like, with respect, he's their leader.
Yeah.
If you read the original Lee and Kirby comics, you know, Reed Richards is an alpha male. He's the George Clooney of the Marvel comics.
He's Stan Lee, you know.
Yeah, of course. Even cooler than George Clooney, he's Stan Lee. So they never really got that right in the later movies, whereas in this one, I feel like they really nail that tone. Everyone looks at Reed with such reverence and respect, you know. Mm-hmm. You see him through Sue Storm's eyes, and she just has a major crush on him.
Reed? I just wanted to say that, well, and whatever comes of this, I mean, even if we don't recover, or if we get worse, something shouldn't go unsaid. God, why am I always so shy around you?
What did you say?
Well, I just wanted
to tell
you...
Susan, what did you just say about being shy?
This is a problem that I have sometimes when...
That's it. Susan, that's it. You've got a problem with being shy, right? So, you vanish, yes? Johnny, you've always had a quick temper. Now, come on, ever since I've known you, right? You could call it fiery, so what happens?
I catch fire.
Exactly.
And me, I've always had this problem. I just stretch myself thin all the time, trying to take care of everybody, trying to do everything at once. Too many things.
Ben, you've always relied too much on brute strength when your intelligence would have sufficed. Don't you see? Listen, we know one thing from the blood test, and that's that our DNA has been altered. But I think Colossus has touched our psyche. I think it's made us feel that our worst character defects are in fact our greatest strengths.
Holy Freud, Batman, I think you're right.
Speaking of Sue Storm,
yes.
Is it pronounced Stabe or Stab?
I think it's Stab.
So it's Rebecca Stab plays the Invisible Woman, and she's mostly a soap opera actress, and you can tell. You can tell she acts this like a soap opera.
Okay.
She did a few episodes of Cheers and Seinfeld, which I found very interesting because I'm a big Seinfeld fan and mm-hmm. Cheers fan. So
I got to look up the episode she was on now.
They, again, like we said, this is based on the 60s version of the characters, but when she falls for Reed, she falls fast and hard. Like, she's immediately in love with him. And here's the very strange thing about that. Early on at the beginning of the movie, we meet Sue Storm and Johnny Storm, and they are, let's say, 13 and 10 at the time. And Reed and Ben are graduate students in college. So they're easily 10 plus years older. And it's like, okay, how does that work? I don't fully get that. And then we'll get into it, but something happens and they fast forward 10 years later. The only difference between Ben and Grimm is Ben Grimm and Reed Richards is Reed has the white in his hair, but Sue Storm and Johnny Storm are 10 years older and they're adults.
Yeah. It's one of those weird...
It's a jump.
Yeah, it's one of those weird things that they would do. Like when you watch Goodfellas and Joe Pesci's supposed to be like the kid.
Yeah.
Supposed to be 25 years old and he's 50 and he's Joe Pesci.
Yeah.
You know, you're like, why do they keep calling him the kid? This guy is older than my dad.
It's one of those suspend disbelief kind of things, and you just gotta go with it.
Yeah, and then, like, you know, the Irishman, when they de-aged De Niro, and he's supposed to be 30, and he looks like he's 60.
Yeah, so, So
it's one of those weird movie things, and, like, it is a little weird that, you know, she's 13 and she has a crush on Reed, but it's such, like, a chaste, innocent relationship in this movie.
Yeah. I could see that.
Yeah, it's very family film, Disney movie kind of thing.
Yeah. So Jay Underwood plays the Human Torch. What is Jay Underwood best known for?
When this movie was announced, or when I heard about the trailer, I went on a deep dive pre-internet and tried to find out every damn thing about this cast. And what I knew Jay Underwood from was a movie called The Boy Who Could Fly, which was on HBO, like, all the time in the late 80s.
Okay.
So that's what I knew him from. He was also in a movie called Uncle Buck.
Which is a fantastic movie. If you've never seen Uncle Buck, go watch it. He plays a character named Bug,
yes,
which is kind of funny because he was in a movie called The Boy Who Could Fly.
Yes, yes. I saw Uncle Buck in theaters.
Did you really?
Yeah. Wow. And it was not appropriate for an 8-year-old. There's a lot of sex stuff.
Yeah.
And I was like with my mom and my younger brother, I'm like, I don't know if we should be watching this. But he was also in, before this, he was in an episode of Superboy where he played a kid who had fire powers. And then after this, he was on an episode of The X-Files where he plays a guy who has fire powers.
Typecasting?
Maybe.
Maybe.
He was born to play the Human Torch, I suppose.
Yeah, that's a little bizarro. So this is where things get very interesting. The Thing and Ben Grimm are played by two different people. So Michael Bailey Smith plays Ben Grimm, but Carl Cifolo or Cifolo?
You're Italian. You got to know this. Chiarfalo
plays the Thing, and he's most notably a stuntman. Now, the actor who plays, and this is the weird thing, when I watch the movie, I'm like, Michael Bailey Smith looks like a young Kevin Sorbo. Like, he's like super handsome, this long flowing blonde hair, and I'm like, you're gonna put the best looking guy in the movie in a giant rubber suit, and then lo and behold I find out he's not even in the suit.
No. So
he has relatively a small part in the movie in comparison to the role he was actually cast for to play the Thing, you know? It's like weird.
Yeah. And if you watch the documentary, he is very bummed that he didn't get to be super in the costume.
Bummed. Like super, super bummed.
And it was mostly just a budgetary thing. They just built a suit around a stuntman just because it was in pre-production, who was noticeably shorter than Michael Bailey Smith.
Noticeably shorter. It's really funny how they do that too.
Yeah. So, but he's also the voice of the Thing.
But it's like, you know, reverbed or like,
yeah,
there's some sort of like voice modulation. I see you can't fully tell that it's his voice because it's got like the Thing grizzle to it, more or less.
Yes, it does. Yes.
Now, go ahead. What were you going to say?
I was going to ask, what did you think of the Thing costume, which was built by a company called Optic Nerve?
I didn't hate it at all. I thought it was fine. I mean,
the glowing review.
There are moments where it's not great, but then when I watched the documentary, I saw the behind the scenes of how they built this like helmet on the guy to make the animatronics of the mouth move. I was like, wow, they did that with like the low budget that they had. It was very impressive. And again, he moves like the Thing. You know, I thought it was, you know, pretty clever. That, you know, it looks good for what they had. It looked like a very good costume.
And to me, that is the best the Thing has looked on film. Yeah. I think the Michael Chiklis costume was awful.
Yeah.
And then the 2015 thing was just the worst thing I've ever seen in my entire life.
That is the worst thing I've ever seen. It's awful.
Put a pair of pants on thing.
Yeah.
Like, what are you doing?
It's not good.
The other funny thing that I wanted to mention about that Thing costume is, again, and we'll get to this as we get to the release, but I was in seventh grade obsessed with this movie and so bummed that it didn't come out. And there was one of those like shows on NBC or ABC for kids about behind the scenes of the movie industry. And in the background of this, you know, effects studio, I saw the thing head. They were interviewing somebody.
Really?
And the thing's head is just sitting like deep in the background. And I'm like freaking out. I'm like, oh my God, it's the thing's
it's
head.
It's there. It does exist.
Yeah. And again, this is pre-Google, pre-internet in everybody's house. So when you got a little piece of information like that, you were just, your mind was blown.
That's pretty funny. That's interesting. So yeah,
that thing had made it onto a TV show at some point.
So Joseph Culp plays Victor Von Doom or Victor, and then he, you know, becomes Dr. Doom. He is the son of Robert Culp of I Spy and The Greatest American Hero. Most recently, he was on Mad Men or Madman.
No, it is Mad Men.
It is Mad Men.
That's my bad.
Yes. Most recently, he was on Mad Men, where he plays Don Draper's father. Interesting.
Wow. Yes. Or Dick Whitman's father. You know, like how Don Draper was somebody else.
Right. Yeah. He's Don Draper.
Yeah.
No matter what his identity really was, no one cares. He's Don Draper.
He's in that famous episode like with the hobo code, where Dick Whitman is visited by a hobo who marks the fence post.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
It's interesting.
Well, that's good. Cool. He's good on it.
Yeah. He is saddled with a mask that muffles much of his dialogue. It kind of reminds me of Dark Helmet combined with Frank Langella's Skeletor. And I agree. It's absolutely like that. You know, it's pretty funny.
It's very over the top when Victor becomes Doom. Like his hands move around like crazy.
But if you've ever read a Fantastic Four comic book, Dr. Doom does kind of move like that. And say what you will, the costume is right from the pages of the comic.
Oh my God, it's dead on. It's completely dead on.
Like it's like they literally ripped a page out and they said, boom, make this. And it is perfect. Like I don't care what anybody says, it is spot on. Every other movie that has come since that have done a Dr. Doom costume is completely wrong. This was it. 100%.
I'm so glad you're saying this because I 1,000% agree. This looks like the Toy Biz figure of Dr. Doom.
Literally.
Come to life.
Yeah.
If you had that as a kid and you went to see this movie, you'd think, oh my God, that's my toy.
Yeah.
They always try to downplay him in the future movies and like make the metal part of some body horror thing, and it just never works. Just give the guy a metal mask and be done with it.
It's so perfect. Like it's like I said, it's as if they ripped out a page of the comic and said, make this, period. And they did it. And that was one of the most impressive things about the movie, is how accurate that costume was. And it blew me away. I was not expecting that at all. And for most of the movie, he's kind of just shot in, you know, nothing behind him, like a literal black background and just like different angles of the mask and just the way like he moves his eyes. It's right on. And I was really, really impressed by that. Really
That's awesome.
Impressed. Yeah, that was impressive. So a guy named Ian Trigger plays the jeweler. Can you tell us a little backstory about this character and why this is in this movie?
So in the original script, this character is just Mole Man, who is one of the more famous Fantastic Four villains.
Yeah.
He's in the first issue of Fantastic Four, which again, they were trying to kind of do that. But at the time, the way they had sold off these characters was so piecemeal that although Bernd Eichinger owned the Fantastic Four and Dr. Doom, he did not own Mole Man. And Marvel, who did not want this movie to happen, who wanted to do a big budget Fantastic Four, get back the rights, didn't want to do him any favors and did not give him Mole Man. It's almost like the 70s Fantastic Four cartoon where they didn't have the rights to Human Torch, so they made Herbie the Robot as the fourth character. So they just basically created a knockoff Mole Man and named him the Jeweler. But to me, I thought he also had elements of the Puppet Master.
Yes.
Specifically, like, in the way he kind of obsesses over Alicia.
Oh, it's so creepy. It's so, so creepy.
Like, yeah.
It's a weird, like, B-plot in the movie, but once it kind of, like, pulls itself together, it makes more sense, in a way. Like, it's not the worst way I've ever seen something cut together that didn't make sense to me at first, but it kind of comes out of left field where he first pops up. But overall, it's pretty good. I have one big complaint about it, but it's not a total deal breaker, so I'm not going to go into it yet. We'll talk about it later.
Okay. And just to mention, Cat Green plays Alicia Masters, and I think she does a great job.
Oh, yeah.
In that role.
She does a great job. She's the only thing that I find weird about that is she's a sculptor. Is she a sculptor in the 60s as well?
That's a good question. Yeah. Yeah, she is.
So
if I'm wrong, please edit it out.
I'm going to leave it in period because I don't care because it's fun. But
flame on.
She does this thing where she's kind of like, so obviously, you know, the character is blind in the comics.
Yes.
And so she's sculpting Ben Grimm's face by just kind of like what she felt for a moment.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very much like Lionel Richie's hello kind of a moment. It's really weird. I'm like, I don't know how I feel about it fully, but it's fine. It's whatever. It's a little cheesy, but it's okay.
It's cute. A note about Cat Green, because I've listened to the audio commentary, you know, 5 times. Her mom is a sculptor, so she took lessons from her mom on how to sculpt in the movie. That's how dedicated she was.
Really?
Playing that role, yes.
So there's also a couple of other fairly recognizable faces that are in this movie. You want to tell us who they are?
Sure. So the first face you see in this movie is an actor named George Gaines, who everyone from our generation knows from Punky Brewster and from the Police Academy movies, obviously.
Yes, obviously.
Commandant Lassard. Yeah. And he just has one scene. He plays the professor in the opening of the movie, and he's very over the top, but
sells
so
it.
Much fun.
So much fun. And I was bummed I didn't see him more in the movie.
Yeah, he's one of those people that I loved as a kid. He's so funny in Police Academy. I loved Punky Brewster, and it's a good open.
It's one of those things where I thought, you know, he'd be sort of like Reed's mentor. And when Reed like reaches his like lowest point, he might go to the professor to like get guidance, but you never see him again in the movie.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a bummer, but the way he moves that chalk against the board, like he's conducting an orchestra. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah.
It's a lot of fun.
Ricky Dean Logan from Freddy's Dead, which I think was released had like Freddy's Dead, A New Nightmare, right?
Freddy's Dead, The Final Nightmare.
The Final Nightmare, that's what it's called. Yes.
Yes.
And a movie that I don't know if I've ever heard of.
Back to the Future 2?
Oh, you just abbreviated.
I'm sorry, yeah. That's my bad.
Like, what the hell is BTTF2? I'm like, okay, is it like...
You have the lingo here.
So he's also in Back to the Future 2. I might just leave that in because it's just so weird.
He's one of Griff's gang.
Oh, yeah.
In Back to the Future 2.
Okay.
He's like, hey, McFly, you bozo, those boards don't work on water.
How do you know these things? How do you know them? Between you.
That was also the first time I saw this and I was watching, I'm like, that's the guy from Back to the Future 2. He plays the busboy in this movie who like has a scene with Thing and he just yells, "What are you, man? What are you?"
It's that guy.
Yeah, that's he just in the 80s. I guess he just got all the high pitched actor roles.
I guess so. An actress named Mercedes McNabb, who was in Buffy, plays young Sue Storm.
Yeah, she was also in the Addams Family movies, both of them. She's in the first one. She plays the Girl Scout.
She's the annoying girl at the camp?
Yes. That's what I thought.
I thought that was her. She looked familiar.
Yep. Well, she's the one that says, I'll play the victim. And Wednesday says, all your life. Yes, she's great in this.
She is great.
Again, small role, but
Yeah.
An actor sells it. Was recognizable.
Yeah.
I've got the movie on in the background. The Ricky Dean Logan scene just popped up.
Really? That's pretty funny. So two actors that I didn't know who they were, but play very significant roles in the movie are Dr. Doom's henchmen, who technically also save him from the hospital and make him into Dr. Doom. Who are those guys?
Is that on the notes?
It's not on the notes. That's why I'm curious.
What are their real names?
Do you know?
There's a book called Forsaken.
Okay.
About the making of this movie. And
there's a book of this movie too?
Oh my God. There's so much.
A book. Of course there's a book. Why would there not be?
It's a really good book, and it's kind of pricey on Amazon, but if you get it for your Kindle, I think it's like $10. I read it at the beginning of quarantine. I picked it up and it was fantastic. I don't remember their names, but
they're good too, and they're a lot of fun.
They are. They kind of remind me of
the Blues Brothers.
The Blues Brothers. That's good. But in Super Mario Brothers the movie, there's the Fisher Stevens character.
Okay. Yeah.
And why am I blanking on the other guy's name from Ferris Bueller's Day Off and all that? Oh, Richard Edelson.
Okay, I see that.
And they're kind of, like Koopa's goofy henchmen.
Yeah.
They kind of remind me of that. There's actually a couple of things in this that remind me of Super Mario Brothers the movie. There's a few, nods to it. Or not nods to it, but a few similarities.
Interesting. Now, there's a couple of notable actors that auditioned for the movie but did not get it. You want to reveal who they were?
Yes, they talk about this in the documentary. There was Mark Ruffalo auditioned for Dr. Doom.
Wow, how young was he then? He must have been
Very young. And what a world we'd be living in right now if the Hulk played Dr. Doom. The other big one was Patrick Warburton, who went on to play the Tick, auditioned for Ben Grimm.
Yeah.
And then Marley Shelton, from The Sandlot, she auditioned for Invisible Woman. So there were a lot of big names that went up or future big names that went up for these roles and just didn't get it.
Wow. Interesting. That's pretty cool. When I heard the Mark Ruffalo thing, I was like, whoa, that's interesting. And
yeah. He would have been great.
I think he would have been great too, yeah. So
I'm sure he would have nailed it.
I'm sure he would have.
He's pretty good, that Ruffalo. He's going places.
He does all right. He's got a show on that HBO network now. I hear it's pretty good. Yeah. So the score was by two guys named the Worst Brothers. But
it's the best score.
But it's an excellent... It almost feels like, a Danny Elfman kind of a score.
It's big. And they talk about this in the documentary. These guys... paid out of pocket for a full orchestra.
Yeah.
Because they were so excited about this movie.
And they worked on this thing. Like, it's really well done. Like, I was very impressed by the score. And again, I watched most of it on my phone, and it still was really, really good.
In the days before, YouTube, where now you can just go online and find the Worst Brothers score, you could pick up a CD of their score at comic book conventions. They were selling it.
Of course they were.
In the early 2000s. I did not buy it. I almost did a couple times, but.
Next comic convention, once the world goes back to some sort of normal, I'm going to get a picture from you saying, I got the soundtrack. I own it now.
Well, it's only about 15 minutes of music, which to pay $20 for that. It's a bit much, but.
It is a bit much. I agree. So now we're going to get into the meat and potatoes. This movie never came out. There are some discrepancies about it. Some claim it was never meant to come out. It was made so that Eichinger could retain the rights, which, if you know anything about Hollywood, this is a thing that they do. Like, Sony was almost going to lose the rights to Venom until they made the Venom movie. It's one of those things.
It is. It's one of those things that's super strange.
Yeah.
Because it was a known property. They did announce it in trade magazines. They put on the whole show to basically make it seem as though this thing were moving forward. There was coverage in magazines like Wizard, Comic Scene. It got the cover story in Film Threat, which I have right next to me. I can hold it up for the camera. Film Threat magazine.
Yeah, I saw that picture on the actual documentary as well.
Yep.
Oh, and for those of you guys who are interested, we're going to release this on the YouTube channel after the podcast comes out, so you'll be able to watch us and relive this if you would like to.
So it's strange because, you know, I've heard both things, that Bert Eichinger or Bernd Eichinger never meant for this to come out, and like I said, was just trying to retain the rights, thought a bigger studio would pay him to just dump this movie. And then I've heard that it was going to be released, and that was the plan all along.
Yeah, and it's very interesting how it comes about, for why. It's a weird mystery that even the documentary doesn't fully solve, but they reveal a lot of interesting nuances about it that I find very, very fun, and it almost raises more questions, which is interesting.
Well, to that point, you know, Roger Corman is one of the most notoriously cheap producers.
Oh yeah, I've heard that.
Film history. If you read if you read Forsaken, they talk about it a lot. And he made two trailers for this movie.
Really?
Yes.
There's two trailers for this movie?
Two trailers.
Wow.
And you know, we were talking earlier about the way this movie looks. If you watch, it's on YouTube and it's on the Blu-ray that I own. If you watch the 35mm trailer, it looks great. I mean,
yeah, that's what they say. They say it looks fantastic.
It looks fantastic. Of course it does. He made posters. There are Fantastic Four posters. He made this promotional button that I have on my...
How did you even find that, eBay?
Yeah. No, actually. So the guy who made Doomed, he wrote a book called The Doomed Journal.
He wrote a book too
about the making of Doom.
Oh my goodness!
I bought, and it's autographed.
It's autographed.
And he had a special deal where if you bought the book, he had some extra buttons. And I saw that, and I had to capitalize. So yeah, it's autographed for me, Steven. So wow.
I have to say, between your wife, my wife, and Adam's wife, they let us get away with a lot of crazy stuff to have in our house.
Yeah. I've got a lot of fan of Corman Fantastic Four stuff. So, but yeah, to that point, it was very odd that he was promoting it so much. And
all of a sudden not.
That movie was made just so that somebody wouldn't lose the rights to make the real movie later.
They had an option on the property.
Yeah, he would have lost his option if he didn't begin principal photography by a certain date. So for a budget of like $1.98, he did that movie, which was really pathetic because the people who did the movie didn't know that it was never intended to be shown.
Right.
They acted and directed and photographed their hearts out.
Right.
They did the best they could, you know? Mm-hmm.
This was actually supposed to premiere. There was a premiere date set at the Mall of America.
Yeah.
On January 19th, 1994. So that was happening. The cast was going out. They were promoting it on their own dime. They were signing headshots. And then, like I said, trailers came out. There's a 35mm trailer. I never saw it in theaters. I don't know anyone who ever saw it in theaters.
I never saw it in theaters either.
If you're listening and you saw it in theaters, please tell the Wizard Podcast, because I want to know. But what did happen was there were trailers that were released on New Horizons videos, New Horizons being Roger Corman's video label.
Right.
And that's, so this leads to the next question. How did you first hear about the Fantastic Four movie, Michael?
From you, actually. From you.
That can't be true.
I mean, actually, you know what? So I had seen pictures of it online, or like snippets of different cheesy things. Like there was a YouTube video I saw a few years ago that had like this the cheesy Justice League kind of like thing that were people wearing the Justice League costumes, and they had like other snippets of ill-fated superhero movies, and there's like a blink if you miss it blip of an image of the Fantastic Four in their costumes, and I was like, what is that? And beyond that, I never really dove too deep to look into it until doing this podcast and you and Adam talking about this movie at nauseam, that I'm just like, okay, I gotta find this thing. And then a former professor of mine from undergrad posted the Daily Motion link on his Facebook account, and I started watching it for about 10 minutes, then stopped. I didn't stop because I didn't like it. I just stopped because life got in the way. And then we started talking about it. You're like, we got to do this podcast. And then it took me the better part of like 6 weeks to get through the whole movie, but I finally watched the whole thing. Now, how did you hear about it?
So I've told the story in the podcast before, but I'll tell it again. I was in seventh grade. I was waiting to get in one day, and a kid in my school, this kid James, he goes, oh yeah, my brother rented a movie last night, and the Fantastic Four trailer was on it. And again, at this point, I was reading the Fantastic Four comics. I had the toys from Toy Biz, which are right behind me. And I was like, what are you talking about? And he goes, yeah, there's like a Fantastic Four movie. And I'm like, what movie is this trailer on? And he goes, I don't know. And so I'm like, well, you have to find out for me. You have to find out what movie he rented so I can rent it and see this trailer. And like I said, in the previous podcast, it took weeks of me bugging him in the hallway to finally get him to tell me what it was. And at one point, he got so pissed at me that he told me it was on a movie called Sliver, the Sharon Stone yes. erotic thriller. And I went to the video store as a 12-year-old and rented Sliver from a female clerk. And I was so embarrassed.
Yeah, you look 18, kid. You look 17.
Like, can I have Sliver? I'm just trying to watch the Fantastic Four trailer. I popped it in and it wasn't on it. And so finally, again, I was like, dude, I rented Sliver. It's not on there. Just what do you like? Tell me one thing you remember about the movie your brother was watching. And he goes, there was a dinosaur in it. And so I'm thinking, I'm like, is it this movie Carnosaur? Like this low budget, nothing movie? He goes, yeah, I think that's right.
How did you even know about Carnosaur at 12 years old?
I was just a movie kid. I just like knew every dumb movie that came out. I knew it wasn't Jurassic Park.
Yeah.
Because that hadn't come out on video yet. And plus, like every kid owned Jurassic Park, so
yeah,
you would have seen it.
Yeah.
So I go to the video store and I rent Carnosaur, and I wore out that trailer, broke the tape on it basically, because I was rewinding it and rewatching it over and over and over again. I rented it multiple times just to watch the trailer.
I was going to say, because a rental usually was only like a weekend or like 2 days tops.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I had it for a couple of days. I'd watch the trailer over and over and over again. And to this day, I like that trailer just gets me. It's one of my favorite movie trailers ever.
Was it an indie video store or was it like a Blockbuster?
I got it from a video store called Broadway Video in Bethpage, New York. So it was an indie video store, but I now have Carnosaur in my collection, the VHS.
Just for the trailer.
Just for the trailer, because the movie Carnosaur is not very good. I just watched it today before we did this. Not a good movie.
Why would you watch that movie? It's so bad.
I was doing work. It was on in the background.
Sure it was. Yeah. That's your reasoning. The trailer is actually on YouTube, and we'll post that to our social as well, so you can
watch it. And you know what? In doing research for this, I found out something I never knew before. Mm-hmm. It's like pretty public knowledge that this trailer is on Carnosaur. My friend John Tarani goes to me, yeah, it's also in a movie called The Skateboard Kid. The Skateboard Kid is a movie where a kid gets a skateboard that's voiced by Dom DeLuise. I swear to God, this is a real movie.
Oh, boy.
Dom DeLuise is the voice of a skateboard.
Oh, okay.
So obviously I'm going to order that on VHS as soon as I can. But I did confirm that it is on there. So if you rent either The Skateboard Kid or Carnosaur from your local Blockbuster tonight, you can watch the Fantastic Four trailer. But
if you're wondering how Steven watches all these VHSs, he has the classic CRT TV with built-in VCR, which was a classic. If you were a 12 or 13 year old kid in the 90s and you got one of those for the holidays, you were like, yes, I have it all.
I remember
all 13 inches of it.
My brother and I are a year apart, and our sister is 10 years younger than us. And so my parents bought a TV for her, like for her bedroom. And my brother and I would constantly just steal it and put it in our bedroom and watch my Seinfeld reruns. Same thing.
It's, my sister has this like white CRT TV with the VCR built into it. And I used to borrow it all the time.
Exact same one. You have to like lug it down the hallway.
Yes, it had handles on the top to carry it. Yeah.
Yeah, recently my parents were getting rid of one, recently, it was like 7 years ago. And they're like, do you want this? And I said, yes, I do.
Obviously.
Yeah.
And how could I not?
Where are we going to put this? I'm like, Anna, don't worry about it.
I'll find a place for it.
Yeah.
Don't you worry.
So basically that was how I heard about it. And then I think a week or two after I saw the trailer, I picked up Wizard Magazine and they said the movie was being ash canned, which meant it was disappearing. I would never see it.
Yeah.
And
that whole thing is really interesting. So in the documentary, they basically said that, I don't know if it was 20th Century Fox or if it was Marvel or whomever, but they basically came into the post house and just took everything, all the negatives, anything with this film was just scooped up in like the middle of the night and just gone the next day.
Yep. Yeah, and so in the Film Threat magazine, they do mention that Steven Spielberg and Amblin were interested in just buying it and shelving it. But eventually it went to Avi Arad, who I guess at the time was at 20th Century Fox, and they bought the rights. Christopher Columbus was coming off Home Alone, or Chris Columbus.
Yeah, I did the same thing the other day. I called him Christopher Columbus, too. I'm like, it's whatever.
I'm thinking of the guy who brought smallpox. Was that Christopher or no?
Yes.
The director of Home Alone. So, you know, Chris Columbus was riding high. He had Home Alone, biggest comedy hit of all time. And Fox knew he was a comic book fan. He wanted to do the movie. They bought the rights for him.
Yeah.
And that was his gift. And he's since yet to make the movie.
Yeah. Seriously. But,
yeah. So I heard about that the fact that it was not coming out in the pages of Wizard.
Wow.
And my seventh grade heart was
broken,
crushed, obliterated.
And they said that they burned all the film. And, you know, they even say this in the documentary. The director's like, you don't burn film. Like, nobody would do that. Because film is like art. It's history. It's like a painting. No matter good, bad, or indifferent, you know, you think of it like this. You know, Indiana Jones, you know, Raiders of the Lost Ark. There is a vault somewhere that has every can of film ever made at some point, you know?
Yeah. I mean, it's again, one of those rumors. Cause again, I'm one of those people. I've Googled Fantastic Four, the movie, maybe a million times since the invention of the internet.
Really?
I look it up constantly and I'm always looking for information if they're ever going to release it. At some point, Shout Factory posted that they had tried to get it and they said it was burned and just gone. And so, yeah, I mean, I think what makes this movie so legendary is what we're going to talk about next, that it was basically canned. We were told it was never going to be released.
Yeah.
And then someone somehow, and they talk about this in the documentary, got out a copy into the world.
Yeah.
And through the bootleg market, this VHS started to spread. And I was reading a magazine called Hero Illustrated one day, which was kind of the crack magazine to the Wizard, basically.
Yeah.
The Wizard's Mad magazine. It was the lesser Wizard. I still liked it. And a guy had reviewed it. He had seen it, one of the staff writers. And so that's when I knew it was out there in the world. And it became my like life's obsession to find a copy of Fantastic Four, the movie. And I was annoying the hell out of
How old were you then? Like 15?
No, I was like 13.
Really?
Yeah. Like, you know how when your parents would say, oh, what do you want for Christmas this year? Give me a list.
I want everything Fantastic Four related.
So
find me the negatives.
I would give them a list. You know, they'd say you could spend $100 or whatever it was. And I'd give them a list and I'd say, listen, at the bottom of the list, it would say, if you can find Fantastic Four the movie, which is $19.99 at conventions, that's all you need to buy me. Just forget about all the other stuff. I don't need a New Jersey Devils hockey jersey. I don't need the Royal Rumble game for Sega Genesis.
Are you a Devils fan?
It was the '90s. We just wore hockey jerseys.
I had a Florida Panthers jersey.
Yeah, exactly.
Why? I don't know.
I had a Canadian jersey because it was on sale at Modell's or whatever. It was 1999. Yeah. And then people were like, "You're not a Canadiens fan." I'm like, "It was $20. What do you want from me?"
More. It's so true. Right? It's so, these are the things we did. Yeah, I had that. I think I had a Tampa Bay Lightning jersey too.
So I would be calling comic book stores on Long Island, going through the yellow pages, calling up, "Do you have Fantastic Four? Do you have Fantastic Four?" And then finally one day, it was my cousin's birthday. My uncle was driving us around comic book stores in Queens. We were going to see Star Trek Generations in theaters. So I was 13. And I stop into a comic book store and I go, do you have the Fantastic Four movie on VHS? And he goes, "No, but I've seen it." And this is the first human being I'd met who'd seen it. And it was a surly Queens guy. And I go, "Oh my God, I'm dying to see it." He goes, "No, you're not." And I'm like, "Yes, I am." He goes, "It's terrible." And I'm like, "Well, I really want to see it." And he goes, "There's a scene where Johnny Storm sneezes and he sneezes out fire, and that's how he knows he's the Human Torch."
And so, you know what? Not bad. It really made a lot of sense.
Yeah.
It was like, oh, they didn't know anything was wrong until he sneezed. That's how they think. Like, oh, that's pretty clever.
Yeah.
I didn't hate it at all. I thought I liked it.
So that guy tells me, he's like, "Hey, there's a convention in New York next week. If you go to that, they'll have it there." And so I went home and begged my dad. I'm like, "Please just take me to this convention." He did not want to go into the city on his day off. You know, typical Long Island commuter.
Yeah.
I'm not going into the city. And so I did not get my copy. It took me years to get a copy.
Really?
Years.
Wow.
Interesting. Many, many years before I finally saw it.
That's so interesting.
Yeah. And if you want me to tell that story, I can tell that story too.
We'll get to it. We'll go down. We got time. We're going down the rabbit hole, if you will.
I did. Yeah, I went on a little rabbit hole.
From the pages of the world's greatest comic book adventure, four heroes on a daring mission in space, but something went wrong. Genetically transformed, they become the most powerful superheroes of all time. Forces of evil are out to destroy their cosmic power.
Find them!
And to survive, they must utilize all their strength. To put an end to their arch nemesis.
Doom? It's clobbering time.
The Fantastic Four.
Thank you for listening to part one of this Fantastic Friday edition of Wizards, the podcast guide to comics. Next week, we're going to continue and dive deeper into the Roger Corman Fantastic Four film. As always, I want to thank Stephen Tsapelas for joining me on this amazing adventure that we've embarked on. And until next time, don't forget to keep your books bagged and boarded. See you next time.